Dr. Strittmatter, thank you so much for coming in. This is an important topic because you're doing great work at Alzheimer's, also spinal cord injury. And we're also going to talk about, is there enough federal funding for guys like you to do research to find cures? So let me just read down who you are. Dr. Stephen Strittmatter, Director of Cellular Neuroscience, Neurodegeneration and Repair, Director Adler Memory Clinic Neurology, and you're also part of a business where you're doing a lot of work there. So you have a lot going on at the same time. Lately in Time Magazine, and this is why you're here, and I'm just going to read this, Yale School of Medicine researchers have discovered a protein that is the missing link in the complicated chain of events that lead to Alzheimer's disease. You reported this in September. What have you found in your lab that could be promising for those who have Alzheimer's disease?
Right, so we're studying how the brain becomes sick in Alzheimer's disease. So there's one thing you may have heard about is these amyloid plaques in the brain of
Alzheimer's.
And let us
know when we're going to put slides up because we have some.
Actually, maybe there's a picture.
So let's go to the first one.
Yeah,
four pictures. Okay, so describe what this is that we're seeing here.
That's the wrong picture.
Oh, okay. So let's slide through them. Tell us when it's the right one. Keep going.
One more.
Right there.
These are amyloid plaques in the brain. And I think many people have heard of amyloid plaques in the brain. In fact, there's new ways to look at them. But in this picture, they're dark on the left-hand side, and they're the red dots. If you zoom into the brain on the right-hand side, these happen in Alzheimer's disease. But most of the brain is still there, all the stuff that's in green on the right or the white on the left. So why does this brain tissue not function right in the presence of this amyloid? Mm-hmm. That's what we've studied. How does amyloid make the neurons sick?
And when we talk about this, just to get it really down into layman's terms, there's a plaque that builds up, and I call it a glue, sticky stuff that starts into the head, which is what you're looking at. If we go to the second picture, as you're finding clues as to how we fix this, just let's go to this one, and what's happening here?
Right, so what, this is an illustration of the surface of a neuron. The red stuff there at the top is this sticky amyloid, and in particular, not the huge plaques, but something called oligomers. These intermediates that are specific for Alzheimer's trigger neuron sickness. And by neuron sickness, we mean the synapses stop working. Changes happen inside the neuron, and then this manifests as problems with cognition, memory disorder, inability to behave correctly.
And let's talk about what is Alzheimer's. And you and I were talking before we went to tape about, you know, I'd be the first person to be in there and be proactive and say something's wrong. Yeah. But you brought up something interesting in that I may not come in, a caregiver would bring me in mm-hmm. because they notice something's wrong first. Describe that, what you see as a physician.
Well, Alzheimer's we could define generally as affecting cognitive performance in all spheres, not just memory, language, the way people interact with in society. And because of this, it changes the way people act. Many times, the thing that really triggers medical care is that family members or acquaintances say something's different and somebody needs to be checked out. It really it robs the personality, it robs people of their existence. And so the way you might react before you have any difficulties with Alzheimer's disease will be different than the way you might act
your
once you have them.
Your personality changes and you don't even know.
That's
it.
That's right.
So the eureka moment in your lab, what happened? In a lab rat? What happened where you said, we've found something that might lead us down the path to fixing this?
Let me just caution. I would like to say that we have eureka moments where one thing changes the entire view. Of course, it's
sure.
a process.
Sure. And it's a long time to getting that fixed.
Right. So I guess we've delved into how this stuff, this amyloid outside the neuron makes the inside of the neuron not work right. And we pinpointed one step, one molecular step after another, One of these steps, the one that's described in this recent paper, is a molecule for which there's already some drugs existing. And so we treated some Alzheimer's mice with these drugs, and their memory improved. So maybe actually I'll show you how we test memory in a mouse. These mice are created, they're Alzheimer's mice, because they were a gene that can cause Alzheimer's in a small sub. Most people don't inherit Alzheimer's, but a few people do. For those people, you can take the gene from the human, put it into the mouse, create a mouse that has something that's akin to human Alzheimer's disease. And in fact, those mice can learn and remember things when they're young, but as they get old, they're unable to remember where things are in a tank of water as they swim around. We gave some Alzheimer's mice this drug, and when we studied their memory, they were able to remember just like healthy mice were. So that was that's the sort of most key moment in this study.
So what's the next step?
There's many steps.
Of course. Being married to a scientist, I know this. But in your lab, what's the next step?
I think a key thing for us is we found this molecule and a drug that blocks it can improve these Alzheimer's mice. There's two key things to go forward. One is this protein has a normal function in the brain. So we want to tweak it so that the Alzheimer's doesn't cause brain dysfunction, but we have to preserve some of its function so it can carry out its normal task. So there's a drug design problem to get the right drug which removes the bad Alzheimer's effect but keeps the normal glutamate-dependent physiology. So that's a drug discovery problem. The other problem is to translate these findings from a mouse model to human.
Right. And then hopefully you get to human trials. If things go the way they are going now, in your lab, in your particular research, and there's a lot of labs doing this research, how long away are you from human trials? Do you even know?
Well, again, there's human trials that would solve the disease. Mm-hmm. I think that's several years away mm-hmm. before they even begin. There are some studies that could happen much more quickly in humans. One is to actually measure the amounts of this target, this drug target, which we call mGluR5. Do we know how much of that protein there is in the brain? We don't in the Alzheimer's brain. So there are imaging agents, so you can actually study the distribution of this protein in a human with Alzheimer's starting today.
So there's a ways to go, and as we are living a long time now in our society, we need you to fix this right away. Let's talk about what is new is a memory clinic, and tell me about that, and who goes there?
Well, there's a new memory clinic in the neurology department.
At Yale.
There have been clinical trials in Alzheimer's at Yale that have been going on for a while. But in particular, there's a diagnostic center in the neurology department that I'm part of. And that's to accept referrals from around the state, around the region, to evaluate dementia with the latest tools, to try to understand people who are beginning to have some difficulties speaking, remembering, behaving, whether this is due to Alzheimer's or one of the several other causes of similar symptoms.
So that's good to know. Let's talk about, and I know this to be true, too, for a number of reasons, that federal monies aren't what they used to be to fund guys like you and other labs across the country. What are we going to do about this?
Write your congressman.
No, this is
well,
exactly.
I mean, that is the solution.
And has it reached a crisis state? Is it headed to there? For the layperson that doesn't understand how this works, the government gives monies to many labs across mm-hmm. the country. What's happening now?
That's right. The engine for research in this country is the National Institutes of Health. It funds most of the researchers at universities throughout the country. The NIH budget, the amount that the country spends on discovering things about health, in real dollars has gone down in the last 10 years. It's gone
markedly
down.
Markedly?
20 to 25%. But, I mean, that's terrible that it's gone down by 20-25% in real dollars. But it's even worse because that cut really destroys the ability of young scientists, scientists in training. It has a huge chilling effect on really innovative research. So when funds are tight, people tend to do sort of safe, you know, incremental studies instead of breaking the box open when there's freedom to explore. So this has a huge
And young people aren't going to go into this if there's
right.
no money.
Exactly.
So write your congressman is what you're saying. Write your senator.
Absolutely.
Make some noise. Let's talk about spinal cord injury and the work that you're doing there. Tell me about that.
Right. Spinal cord injury, unfortunately, like Alzheimer's, is a big medical, it's not as big a medical problem, but it's a problem where we don't have a treatment. When people suffer injuries, they remain paralyzed or without sensation below the level of the injury for decades. And we as neurologists, apart from the first day or two in the hospital, there's nothing we can do really. So the research that we're interested in is how to get recovery of function. A dramatic thing is that in spinal cord injury, the real problem is about disconnection. So there's nerve cells up in the brain and spinal cord above a level where there's been an injury, and there's nerve cells below that level. For example, if somebody's damaged in the middle of their back, they'll lose the use of their legs.
Sure.
But in fact, the cells that go from the lower part of the spinal cord out to the leg are completely fine. They're just not connected to the brain. So it's a disconnection problem. The wires, not the cells, are lost. So our research is about the wires, the connections from one cell to another in the brain. Those are called axons. And when spinal cord injury happens, the axons are cut and they just sit there. They don't grow back. In the young brain or out in the arm or the leg, if they're cut, they'll grow back. So we study what prevents them from growing back. We've discovered a couple molecules that play a role in this. In particular, the white matter, or called the myelin of the brain, puts a brake on the ability of the brain to grow and sprout fibers and recover. That's in fact why young kids who have a spinal cord injury or any other kind of injury recover much better. So if we know these breaks, we've developed ways to block the break, a double negative, which allows growth to happen.
How close are you to, I'm going to ask you that again, how close are you to maybe, I have an uncle who's a paraplegic, so I know firsthand what happens. And it was an injury, and it slowly took his movement away. It didn't happen like that, of course. Is the thinking, if you get to somebody very quickly after an injury, that you can maybe help them more? What's the thinking behind
that? Well, there's two sort of approaches. One is you get in there, many injuries, perhaps different from what you're describing, like a car accident happens bang all at once.
Yes.
That's the most common cause. In those cases, one kind of treatment is to get in there within the first hour and try to stop the damage, so the axons don't get cut in the first place. But that's totally separate than trying to get the nervous system, after whatever damage has happened, to sprout, regrow, recover. That's the approach that we're taking. And so in some sense, it doesn't matter how far out it is. In fact, there are studies in humans, people who've had a spinal cord injury and then survived for decades and died for some other cause. If you look at their spinal cord, the nerve fibers that were coming down the spinal cord are still there. They just sit
they
there
just
and do nothing useful.
Them.
They won't grow into the lower part of the spinal cord.
So into wrapping up here, we've talked about a lot of things. We've talked about Alzheimer's and the work that you're doing in your lab. We've talked about spinal cord injury. We've talked about right your lawmaker to get this money back to researchers across the country. Leave us with some good news.
I think we're making real progress in understanding these diseases, especially in neuroscience. It's really a time when we know a whole lot more about the brain, And if we apply just a little more pressure, and by that I mean a little more research, a little more investment, we can make a real difference in healthcare and the diseases that too many of us are suffering from.
That's a great way to end it. Dr. Stephen Strittmatter, thanks so much for being on.
My pleasure. It was a great pleasure.
Thanks.